Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. I thought that we would just cover a little bit of intraoperative stapedotomy difficulties and complications. My name is Dr. Louisa Brownell. I'm one of the UCT registrars here. And for the purpose of today's talk, I'm really only focusing on intraoperative, not postoperative difficulties with stapedotomy. And I think when I first started as a junior registrar, I found a stapes procedure quite daunting. And, you know, it was this presentation and the information that Prof. Harris gave actually made it a lot easier. So I hope that it's beneficial to everyone. When we talk about stapes surgery, we have some very specific goals for surgery. Our goal is really to achieve maximum hearing gain with minimal damage to the membranous labyrinth. The indications of surgery are when we want to try and achieve normal hearing in patients that have normal cochlear reserve, and that normal, and we want to try and close it within a 10 dB airbone gap. A secondary outcome would be, I'm just going to ask this person to mute themselves. A second goal of surgery would be to achieve serviceable hearing in patients with slightly reduced cochlear reserve, and perhaps even eliminate the need for patients to wear a hearing aid if they've already been fitted with a hearing aid. A third goal may be to actually just achieve hearing aid satisfaction. These are patients that have good speech discrimination scores and with large airborne gaps, so airborne gap greater than 30 dB. So when we look at stapes surgery, the role is really primarily otosclerosis. Otosclerosis by far accounts for around 95% of stapes surgeries performed. Otosclerosis, as I'm sure you know, is a localized hereditary bone disorder where you have endochondral bone of the otic capsule that's characterized by abnormal bony reabsorption and deposition of bone. There are subtypes of otosclerosis. We get stapedial, cochlear, and a mixed form of otosclerosis, depending on which anatomical sites are involved. And a second role where we would consider doing stapes surgery is in something like even congenital stapes fixation. In this particular subgroup of patients, our postoperative hearing outcomes are not as good as an otosclerosis, but certainly it is an option to offer these patients with regards to surgery. When would we not consider doing a stapedotomy? We would not consider doing a stapedotomy in patients with an only hearing ear, if that's the ear that you were thinking about doing this procedure on. In patients with significant tympanosclerosis, if your patient has a history of vertigo in the past couple of months, for example, fluctuating hearing loss or a history of possible endolymphatic high drops, these would not be good candidates for this procedure. If they have an active external ear infection or a history of chronic otitis media, one should be careful about selecting these patients. If your patient is at the extremes of age, if they are known to have poor eustachian tube function, if they are currently pregnant, and also if they are poor operative candidates and have poor operative fitness. Preoperative counseling these patients is extremely important. We want to kind of try and cover all options for treatment because, you know, your patients may not actually even want a surgery, and there are other options that you can offer these patients in the form of a hearing aid. Obviously, all of these options have advantages and disadvantages for each. So preoperatively, when we are assessing these patients, things that we want to talk to them about are that, you know, one option may even be to only observe. This is in the case of patients with hearing loss less than 30 dB. And in these patients, this might be a good place just to sit tight and observe it rather than being more aggressive and going for stapes surgery. You may also opt to offer patients a hearing aid. These are the patients that have sort of a moderate hearing loss, and they are the ones that sometimes don't want surgery or have other anesthetic concerns that deem them unfit. In a patient with cochlear otosclerosis and a progressive sensory neural hearing loss, you may also consider the medical option of supplementing them with vitamin D, calcium, or even sodium fluoride, just to try to temporize the progression of disease. Of course, and then our last option is surgery. Surgery for stapes comes in the form of stapedectomy, as well as stapedotomy, with stapedotomy being the focus of today's talk. And obviously a cochlear implant in the patients that are no longer benefiting from hearing aid and now have profound hearing loss. The difference between stapedotomy and stapedectomy. Briefly stated, stapedotomy tends to give us better hearing function, better high frequency hearing gain, and has a much lower incidence of perilymphatic fistula, sensory neural hearing loss, and postoperative vertigo, etc. With a stapedectomy giving you better low frequency hearing gain, and sometimes stapedectomy is the only method possible. Patients that benefit most from stapy surgery is the subset that experience hearing loss in everyday life. This is usually when the air conduction is 30 dB or worse. If we have patients with bilateral cases, which is the majority of otosclerotic patients, we want to operate on the worst ear first. The worst ear is assessed not only on the audiogram, but also on the patient's subjective experience. Some of the features that we have to consider that may indicate that there are that there's an alternate diagnosis or a mimicker of otosclerosis should be considered flags and should always be going through your mind when you are preoperatively counseling these patients. These flags might be if you have only a patient with unilateral hearing loss, the age of onset of hearing loss, although it could present in childhood as well. If there's no typical history of progressive hearing loss over time, if there's a history of vertigo, or if there's any associated ear discharge or history of trauma. These are really the flags that should alert you that perhaps this is not otosclerosis and perhaps you should rethink the procedure that you're offering the patient. Surgically, at our institution, certainly our stapes procedures are performed under general anesthetic, but there are some institutions that are happy to do these patients under local anesthesia. For general anesthesia, this is generally preferred, as if you experience any intraoperative difficulties, these are far more easily managed. And for your operative field, which can be quite technical, there's no movement of the patient, which is obviously beneficial. But it can be done under local anesthesia. This gives you an opportunity to assess real-time hearing. The patient can communicate whether or not they're experiencing any vertigo symptoms or disequilibrium. And also you can, in this way, you might be able to reduce the post-operative nausea that the patient experiences. The surgical steps for a stapedotomy, either you want to do an end-oral or transcanal approach. You're going to elevate your tympanomeatal flap. You'll curette the scutum and to expose and have good visualization of the oval window. Then you want to sequentially assess the mobility of the ossicles and confirm your preoperative concern about otosclerosis to confirm your diagnosis by looking at the movement of the foot plate. You will need to measure the length of the piston required. You want to separate your incurostapedial joint. That will be followed by cutting the stapedial tendon and then removing the stapy superstructure. You'll then perform a stapedotomy. There are various ways to do this, either laser or others. And then you want to place and crimp the piston. This is obviously very simply put, and there are variations of these surgical steps. I think the important thing is to try to anticipate any intraoperative difficulties that you don't want to encounter unexpectedly during surgery. Most causes that lead to sensory neural hearing loss are due to the intraoperative complications, and anticipating them enables you to be able to deal with them adequately. And for this reason, your pre-op working and adequate counseling is really important in these patients. Preoperatively, you may assess a patient by otomicroscopy. And what you're looking for is you're looking for a really nice, normal, stable, intact tympanic membrane without any retraction pockets. In otosclerosis, they do typically describe the short sign, which is indicated in the image in the bottom right. But at the same time, you also want to assess for other things. Is your canal adequate? And is there any presence of exostoses? If you have exostoses that is quite significant, you may opt to do your stapedotomy rather as a stage procedure. And if you think that canaloplasty might be required due to a bony narrowing, then you want to really try and drill this down before you enter the middle ear cavity. Preoperatively, you're obviously going to look at audiological evaluation. This is done by looking at speech audiometry, and your speech audiometry normally should increase as the sound intensity is increased. Patients that have speech discrimination scores of less than 60% won't really benefit from surgery, in particular in otosclerosis. You should have a type A or an AS TIM. Your pure tone averages can demonstrate a conductive or a mixed hearing loss. Then very classically in otosclerosis, you have this conductive hearing loss a conductive hearing loss with an ear bone gap that's greater and that's more notable in the lower frequencies, and you have the typical Carhartt notch. The Carhart notch is not specific for arthrosclerosis and can also be found in other forms of conductive hearing loss. If you have a consistent pan-cochlear ear bone gap, that's really atypical of arthrosclerosis, and you should consider other things in your differential. That's where we get a very wide ear bone gap that doesn't have that typical Carhart notch. Audiologically, surgical indications. Historically, we used to use an ear bone gap of around 20 dB, but now it can range anywhere between 10 to 20 decibels on your ear bone gap. Bone conduction thresholds of more than 15 decibels at 2000 kilohertz suggest underlying arthrosclerosis. As we mentioned, if you don't have a Carhart notch, you have to exclude other causes of conductive hearing loss. And here it's really useful to look at the stapedial reflexes. They should be absent in arthrosclerosis. So if they are present, then you may want to do a high resolution CT temporal bone to exclude other third window lesions. This might be semicircular canal dehiscence. You want to have a look for any features that may suggest that this patient has a gaseous syndrome, and for other things such as facial nerve neuroma and anonymous facial nerve. What are some of the differentials to consider in your mind other than arthrosclerosis? Well, it could be any acicular chain discontinuity, significant tympanosclerosis, if you've got malleus head fixation, even some minor middle ear malformations. Paget's disease and osteogenesis imperfecta would all be other differentials to consider. If we are going to perform a CT, we should have some sort of checklist in our mind prior to performing stapedotomy. To note, arthrosclerosis is a clinical diagnosis that's confirmed at the time of surgery, but a high-res CT temporal bone with thin slices can be helpful to exclude other causes of conductive hearing loss, as previously mentioned, or when your diagnosis is in doubt. If we are going to do a CT scan, in terms of a checklist, these are the things that we should really be looking out for. We should be looking for the presence of an arthrosclerotic focus at the fissure antefenestrum. We want to have a look to see if there's concomitant obliteration of the round window. Is there any evidence of cochlear sclerosis? This can be demonstrated by a halo sign or even what they describe as being a third basal turn of the cochlea, and it's sort of a radiological impression. We want to evaluate if there's any risk for CSF gusher, that may be an enlarged aqueduct or enlarged internal artery meatus. Is there additional fixation of the malleus and or incus? Is there fullness that suggests that maybe this patient has a persistent stapedial artery? So as we mentioned, a CT is useful to diagnose other pathology and any other anatomical variants, or if your diagnosis is in doubt. In essence, we want to double check, is there any semicircular canal dehiscence as illustrated in the image B? You want to gain an impression to see whether or not there's an overhanging facial nerve that might impair the ability to place the piston. And you want to see if there's any presence of a stapedial artery. Okay, with regards to the surgical steps and intraoperative difficulties that one might experience, you want to really try and infiltrate the skin of the ear canal very well. This is really important because to get this right helps you so that you don't have bothersome bleeding later on during the procedure. You can do an end oral or transcanal approach. Our institution favors an end oral approach, but you have to assure that good hemostasis is achieved in order to do this operation successfully. You want to elevate your tympanomeatal flap. At this point, an intraoperative complication you may experience is damage to the chorda tympani whilst raising this tympanomeatal flap, or even a tympanic membrane perforation. The tympanic membrane perforation occurs in around 2% of cases, and it may occur during elevation of the flap in that posterior inferior area from the sulcus. But it doesn't preclude the completion of the stapedotomy. You can simply do an underlay meningoplasty with temporalis fascia or even cartilage. And we suggest that you avoid placing spongistan in the middle ear cavity. If you've damaged the chorda tympani, injury to the chorda tympani is usually by stretching of the nerve, mobilization, or when you're trying to enter the middle ear. It gives your patient a temporary metallic taste postoperatively. To note that a stretched nerve actually produces a lot more symptoms than a simply sacrificed nerve. And this damage to the chorda can be avoided by actually leaving it attached to the tympanic membrane as you elevate. You then want to subsequently try to get good exposure of the oval window. The intraoperative complications or difficulties you may experience at this point is subluxation of the incus. you may encounter an overhanging facial nerve. You may now see that you have a very narrow oval window. You could discover that you have an obliterative atherosclerosis, or you may note a persistent stapedal artery. With an overhanging facial nerve, this occurs in around 9% of cases and can cause partial or complete obliteration of the footplate. The facial nerve can overhang the footplate, and that really limits your access in order to be able to place the piston. If your access is completely blocked, making your stapedotomy impossible, you have to abort your procedure, counsel your patient, and consider offering your patient perhaps even hearing aids. If there's partial obliteration, you can usually complete the surgery. You might consider using something like a buccal handle prosthesis. The facial nerve may really herniate over the oval window, and a piston that touches the facial nerve is usually not such a problem. You may displace the nerve superiorly whilst doing a stapedotomy. The second complication that we can just talk about at this point is subluxation of the incus. This really most commonly occurs at the stage when you're trying to curette. Incorrect curetting technique during curetting of that bony annulus can lead to subluxation. And to prevent poor technique, what we want to do is we want to use the index finger of your non-dominant hand to stabilize the curette anteriorly, as demonstrated by the picture. And you would consider separation of the incus stapedal joint. If you have subluxation of the incus, you may opt to remove the incus and then proceed to a malleostapedotomy. And that's why it's important that when you consent these patients preoperatively, that you do consent the patient for both malleostapedotomy and also stapedotomy. If you encounter a very narrow oval window, if it's partially obstructed, you can use an 8mm diamond burr, for example, the skeeter drill, and that can allow you to create a little bit more space. There is, of course, a small risk of acoustic trauma. Alternatively, you could also create more space by removing the incus, but then proceeding to do a malleostapedotomy. If you encounter persistent stapedial artery, the stapedial artery usually arises from the internal carotid artery. It actually tends to occupy the anterior half of the footplate, so you can proceed to do a stapedotomy in the posterior half, but only if there really is clear, sufficient space for the fenestration. The persistent stapedial artery in the CT imaging is indicated by the soft tissue in the middle ear, as seen on the imaging scan. And in the image on the right, that's where you can actually clearly see a persistent stapedial artery. It's quite a nice image. And in this one, the piston has been placed successfully in the posterior aspect. If you encounter obliterative atherosclerosis, that occurs around about 3 to 11%. And you can usually anticipate this by looking at your CT scan. If you do have it in one ear, you've got about a 50% chance of having it in the other ear. And this is very useful in order to be able to counsel patients appropriately. What you want to do, you will also assess the round window niche routinely once you've elevated your tympanic membrane. And then about 1% is complete round window atherosclerosis, and this may cause you to abandon the procedure. If it's incomplete, though, you may be able to proceed by completing your stapedotomy. Just to continue on obliterative atherosclerosis, if you have complete obliteration, that really means that your footplate, your annular ligament, and your oval window niche are all involved. The laser is not going to be sufficient, and you may even cause a facial nerve injury due to the excessive amounts of heat generated. You also don't want to use perforators because you run the risk of developing a floating footplate. So in this circumstance, you'd use a skeeter drill for fenestration, a 0.7mm. A closure of air bone gap postoperatively in this subset of patients to less than 10 B is far less common, and refixation postoperatively is also common in obliterative atherosclerosis. You always want to check for any evidence of fixation of any of the additional ossicles. This should be done routinely, where you assess the entire ossicular chain individually in every case. And if you don't have, this may be one of the reasons that you have non-closure of your postoperative air bone gap. It's usually associated with stapes fixation, but it can also occur alone. Management options if you have fixation of additional ossicles are either to abort the surgery and offer the patient a hearing aid, or to remove the incus and head of malleus and do an ossicular reconstruction. The intraoperative difficulty experience is that you may have additional fixation of the malleus head, the incus anterior malleal ligament, and the incomalleal joint. here you'll need to do malleostapedotomy. With malleostapedotomy, there is, of course, a higher risk of hearing loss, so you must add this in your consent form independently. If you're going to address additional ossicular fixation, you really do need good, adequate exposure. We prefer to do an end-oral approach with a nice, large tympanomapal flap. You may consider doing canaloplasty, and you also want to do an anterior canal incision to assess the anterior malleal ligament. A note on malleostapedotomy. For malleostapedotomy, you want to remove the incus. You may see fixation of the incus or malleus head or the incudomalleal joint. The middle image just demonstrates the removal of the head of the malleus. This demonstrates the fixation of the malleus head. And lastly, this is really an end image of a malleostapedotomy having been performed. Okay, the next intraoperative difficulty you may find is when you, at the time of removing the stapes arch and perforating the footplate, this intraoperative difficulty can come as a floating footplate, a fractured footplate, or even a perilymphatic gusher. With a floating footplate, the footplate is depressed into the vestibule. This is usually an iatrogenic injury when you attempt to fracture the pleura. It can be, the injury experience can be mobile, in which case you need to consider whether you're happy to proceed or whether you need to terminate the procedure. The footplate could be totally submerged. You should not try to retrieve if it is completely submerged. You should rather graft it. Or it could be partially submerged, and then you can consider hook retrieval. So the management steps for a floating footplate, some people would advocate removing it if it's partially submerged. You may opt to abort and seal that opening with a graft, and then proceed to a stapedotomy or a reattempt in 1 year after refixation has occurred. You could consider using a laser to perform the stapedotomy if you're comfortable with that. And then importantly, perilymphatic fluid suctioning should be avoided as you run the risk of giving the patient hearing loss, sensorineural hearing loss, and a dead ear. These are some images of fractured stapes footplate. If this occurs, you might try to carefully elevate the fragments with a 0.2 millimeter elevator, and then you want to seal off that opening with some connective tissue. With regards to perilymphatic gusher, this is where you have a profuse flow of perilymph on entering the vestibule. It's very rare. It's about a 0.03% chance in patients that are in surgeons that are regularly performing stapedotomy. But you want to be able to anticipate this in high-risk patients. The high-risk patients are usually your males with a strong family history of hearing loss, as in X-linked gusher. But it's not unheard of, and it can obviously occur in females as well, not only in males. On history, what might lead you to consider this is that they often have a mixed progressive hearing loss since early in childhood. And audiologically, you'll see this mixed hearing loss, and they have intact reflexes. Your CT findings could also be normal, but you may get the impression of a large vestibular aqueduct or IAM. How would you manage this if this occurs? You can give the patient mannitol, 10%. You really want to raise and elevate the head of the bed to 45 degrees. You'll place a tissue graft over the oval window, and then most people would proceed and try and place the prosthesis with a flat seal from one ear lobule. You can do that as a one-stage procedure. You may consider a lumbar drain and packing the middle ear, but that's really only if it's severe recalcitrant fistulas. How could we prevent stapes footplate complications? Well, you want to assess the type of footplate before you're going to decide what instrument you want to use for the stapedotomy. If you have a blue footplate, you may consider using a laser. However, if you have a biscuit footplate, you really want to be using the skeeter drill rather than the laser. The images just demonstrate the handheld laser and the skeeter drill, and as well as the manual perforators in varying sizes. And then lastly, we just wanted to talk a little bit about reverse stapedotomy, which we commonly perform at our institution. In essence, you can see in the image on the left, you can see the long process of the incus, and you can see the stapedial tendon. A stapedotomy is done. The stapes superstructure, stapedial tendon, and the incudostapedial are all still left intact versus taking those down first before doing the stapedotomy. With these structures intact, the stapes piston is placed and then crimped. And then subsequently, the stapedial tendon is cut and your eye is joined to separate it. And the superstructure is subsequently fractured off. And that's really a reverse stapedotomy. So during stapedotomy, for reverse stapedotomy, your intact eye is joined, resist the tendency of the foot plate to sink into the vestibule, creating a floating foot plate. During crimping, your intact joint keeps the long process of the incus stable, preventing subluxation of the incus. While you remove the stapes superstructure, the secured piston actually prevents the foot plate from coming out of the oval window niche. The one thing to note is that you are unable to reverse the steps if you have a very, very narrow oval window niche. So in conclusion, stapes surgery is a good example of a good combination of science and art. Good patient selection and counseling preoperatively is really important with regards to expected outcomes and possible complications intraoperatively and what your management options for those would be. It is a highly rewarding surgery for both the patient and the surgeon when done well. And we want to really be familiar with the technical armamentarium of surgical skills, which allow us for improvisation when faced with difficulties in a way that's still in the best interest of the patient. Thank you. I'm not sure if there's any questions or comments, maybe people that do a lot of stapes.
I've got a comment. Thanks, Louisa. Nice presentation. Obviously, your presentation illustrated that stapes surgery has a lot of nuances and a lot of potential complications. Having presented this, do you think stapes surgery should be restricted to otologists with a high caseload of stapedotomies? Or do you think it's something that should be within the realm of the general ENT skills? And do you think we should be training registrars for stapedotomies?
It's a difficult one, but I'm a bit biased because I enjoy otology. I don't think that stapes surgery should be performed by people that are caged during years. I think complications can be quite significant, and a lot of these patients do have residual hearing that could be augmented conservatively by a hearing aid. I think it's great if you are in a facility like ours and you get good exposure to stapes surgery. I think it's a nice concept to be able to grasp when you've seen the steps. But in my opinion, I think it should really be pursued by people that are serious about doing otology long-term rather than the occasional otologist that's defined an artist, if that's what it's like.
Yeah, I mean, I think I worked in the UK for a bit, and there the NICE guidelines are that you're going to be doing them, you need to be doing at least a minimum of 5 years, which isn't a lot, but like a minimum of time. So I think if you're doing 1 or 2 a year, it's just not, you know, some, if you attend these huge apology meetings, a lot of the apologists feel that you spend your lifetime actually still on the zoning curve, if you know what I mean. So even in your entire lifetime of only doing ear surgery, you're always on that curve when you get a platter. So it is tricky. I think most of it, when it's straightforward, it's fine. But I think the important thing to remember is, this is lifestyle surgery for the patient, there's another option.
Yeah.
So it's not something you want to, and your first surgery is going to be the best outcome. The minute you start having to do the revision surgery on the patient, because the first result was you rate, then the complication rates go up, the natural rate, or increase risk of the patient. So, I think there's a lot of sort of general, I think the general consensus internationally is we are doing them a lot.
Cool. Thank you, Tishni. I don't see any further comments or questions in the chat. Okay. If there's no more comments, thank you very much for attending this morning. We will see you again on Friday. I'm going to end the meeting. Thanks.